the variables now are the deviation from the equilibrium point. These become the new variables in the local linear neighborhood, and the whole differential equation is like this. So, we can say x dot, x is that vector A times x. So, that is the differential equation I have written here in terms of these are the vectors and this is the matrix, this is another vector. Now, if the system is one dimensional, then the differential equation would be like this, and we know at least this much, allow me to assume that its solution is like this. At least this much you allow me to assume. So, this is a simple result, and we will try to cast everything that is relatively more complicated in terms of this simple result. So, what do we do? We simply take the logic that the actual vector in two dimensions is this vector, which is x and y, and if we can find linearly independent solutions like this, then we can compose the solution of the differential equation in terms of the linearly independent solutions. That's all. So we simply count on that theorem that says that if we can somehow find, somehow how, we'll come to that later. If we can somehow find two linearly independent solutions, then any solution is a linear combination of those two. So the next problem is to somehow find the two linearly independent solutions, and that's where the eigenvalues and eigenvectors of the matrix A will come to our rescue. Well, this much you definitely know. The eigenvalues are essentially a solution of this equation. So A applied on x gives simply a number times x. So, these x are those special directions in the phase space such that if we apply that matrix A on that vector, you get nothing but a number times the vector, which means that that vector becomes either longer or shorter or opposite or something like that, but in the same direction. If it is in the same direction, then it becomes effectively a one dimensional stuff whose solution we know. Therefore, you can write in that direction a solution in this form. In a two dimensional system, a square matrix of two dimensions, 2 by 2 matrix, there will be two such eigenvalues, two such eigenvectors, and therefore, we can find two such solutions similar like this. Let us do an example. Suppose the equation is like this. You do this. Obtain the eigenvalues and eigenvectors of this. Do this. Eigenvalue at least is halfway done here in this slide. You go ahead and complete it. Yes. And then eigenvectors. Obtain the eigenvalues and eigenvectors. It is a simple first year problem. Just for the sake of recapitulation, we are doing this. What are the eigenvectors? What eigenvalues are? 1 and 3, you said?
Minus 1, minus 3.
Yes. And this eigenvector is?
1, 1.
Good. And its eigenvector is?
Minus 1.
You have all done that? Minus 1, minus 3 is right. Yes. Okay. So, I suppose you have done this, right? Now, in the direction of the eigenvector, which is eigen direction, if you take an initial condition here, then the solution will be this value times e to the power lambda t. Now, this e to the power lambda t, depending on the value of lambda, is either exponentially increasing or exponentially decreasing stuff. Whatever it is, it will be in this direction. So, this vector either goes in the becomes bigger and bigger or becomes smaller and smaller, depending on the value of lambda, right? But all the way it remains on this line, and therefore the system becomes 1D. So, if you choose an initial condition on the eigenvector direction, I effectively have a one dimensional equation. That one dimensional equation we know how to solve. So, its solution will be like this. There is another direction for which it will be like that, and so the total solution is simply a linear combination of these two solutions, as simple as that. Clear? So, solving a linear set of differential equations is extremely simple in terms of the eigenvalues and eigenvectors. But the reason that we want to do is that it gives us a visual perspective, which often in mathematics courses you don't get. We want to get a visual perspective. Yes, it is possible. It is possible highly possible. One eigenvector direction. We'll come to that case. Yeah. So, for example, if you have a matrix like this, an equation like that, then you can find the eigenvalues to be like this and eigenvectors. So, the first solution in the first eigenvector direction is like this, and the solution in the second eigenvector direction is like that, and therefore, the total solution is like this. I will give you such a problem for you to do during the tutorial, right. So, notice the way I am writing the solution. I am writing the solution x, which is x and y, is a constant times the exponent times a vector. So, the x part of this will be the first row, the y part will be the second row. Okay? So, this is how we normally write the solution.
Looking at right eigenvectors, the eigenvectors on the right, they could be left eigenvectors.
Yes.
They don't have such a significance.
No, they don't have such a significance, yes. So, we have a situation like this, we are writing the solution like this, but we are trying to now get a visual picture of the dynamics in the phase space. Now, notice that suppose a situation has the eigenvectors like this and the fixed point is initial condition is there. So, what will happen? It says that its position can be resolved into two components, one is this component and another that component, and this component will decay because the eigenvalue in this direction is minus 2, it will decay as e to the power minus 2, and in this direction it will decay as e to the power minus t, because the minus 1 t, the eigenvalue is 1. So, this in this direction is decayed faster, in this direction it decays slower, and therefore, its evolution will be in this direction and it will converge onto the equilibrium point. Okay? So, just by looking at the equations, you can visualize the dynamics. That is important in the phase space. Visualizing the dynamics, being able to visualize the dynamics is extremely important in when doing dynamics. So, why did I conclude that it will converge onto the equilibrium point? Because both the eigenvalues are negative. So, the initial condition, its magnitude, its value is multiplied by e to the power lambda t, that lambda is negative, therefore, that value will progressively decrease, or the deviation from the equilibrium point will progressively decrease and it will converge onto the equilibrium point. Now, that allows us to figure out that there can be a few qualitatively different types of dynamical behavior, local linear dynamical behavior. If both the eigenvalues are negative, it will be like this. If both the eigenvalues are positive, it will progressively increase in all possible directions. Okay? But what if it is negative, one eigenvalue is negative, another eigenvalue positive? Then in one direction it increases, another direction it decreases. A situation like this, which is called a saddle. A saddle. See the horse's saddle. So this one direction in which it increases, another direction it decreases. So it's like that. It's called a saddle fixed point. Yeah. No, no, I didn't say that.
Okay. In these cases,
yes. I didn't say that it will be real. I have only yet dealt with real eigenvalues. Yeah, I mean, if you have a square matrix, it could as well give an imaginary or complex eigenvalues, right? It can, of course. So far, I have dealt with only real cases, right? First, let us understand real cases, and then we'll go to complex, right? So you have three possible situations resulting from real eigenvalues. This is called a attracting node. This is called a repelling node, and this is called a saddle. These are the nomenclatures of the equilibrium points. An equilibrium point will be called an attracting node, a repelling node, or a saddle, depending on the eigenvalues around the equilibrium point. Remember, the whole thing has been obtained by locally linearizing around the equilibrium point. Now, if the eigenvalues are complex conjugate, then they will have two parts, one the real part and the imaginary part, and it will be e to the power this whole stuff, and the e to the power the whole stuff means e to the power lambda t, the sigma t. E to the power sigma t is same thing, either increases or decreases. But e to the power I omega t means what? It is a sinusoid, right? So it is a product of an exponentially increasing or decreasing term multiplied with a sinusoid. So all that will happen is that the result is that this exponentially, in this case I have drawn the exponentially decreasing thing that will form the envelope in which the sinusoid will be encased. So it will be either a exponentially decreasing sinusoid or an exponentially increasing sinusoid. What does it depend on that? It depends on whether the real part is negative or positive. So this real part is all important in this case. This imaginary part defines what? Defines the frequency of oscillation. And the real part defines what? Defines whether it will be stable or unstable, whether it is increasing or decreasing. How will it look in the phase space where x, y is plotted? It will look like this. What I just showed, a decreasing sinusoid will look like an incoming spiral. An increasing sinusoid will look like an outgoing spiral. While if the eigenvalue is having a zero real part, which is a purely imaginary eigenvalue, then it will be neither expanding nor, so the effect result will be perfect sinusoid. And then depending on the initial condition, it will go round in different radii. Remember this. If the radius is large, it will go into a large circle. If the radius is small, it will go into a small circle, but it will go into actually sinusoid. Okay. So this is what happens if the results are complex conjugate. Now in 3D, there will be three eigenvalues. If there are three eigenvalues, the possibilities are A, all the eigenvalues are real, one eigenvalue is real, another two complex conjugate, it has to conjugate, remember, it cannot have be anything else. So complex conjugate plus one real, that one real could be positive or negative, that complex conjugate could be positive real part or negative real part, all these possibilities exist. But yes, the moment, so far if you have understood what I have said, you can easily visualize, you can close your eyes and visualize how the dynamics will be. You don't have to really work out how it will be, you can visualize that. If, for example, by looking at this, can you immediately say what the eigenvalues are? Yes, because it is converging in this direction, in the real direction. So, therefore, one real negative eigenvalue. In this plane, it is expanding, is going in spiral outward, which means that it has a complex conjugate with a positive real part. So, it is possible then to visualize dynamics this way. How will it look if the real part, real eigenvalue is negative and the complex conjugate has negative real part? How will it look? See, then there is a plane associated with the complex conjugate eigenvalues, and in that plane it is stable because it has negative real part. The other one is also negative and therefore it will progressively converge. So, suppose it starts here, it will progressively converge, which means it is going in this direction. It is rotating in this direction, but the rotation is slowly decaying and it will converge onto this point. So, the moment you know the qualitative character of the eigenvalues, you more or less know what the behavior could be. This is what we know as the qualitative dynamics of the system. We do not all the time bother about exact quantitative nature, where exactly is the point going to be. Rather, we are more interested in the what it can do. Will it collapse? Will it go to infinity? Will it converge onto the equilibrium point? So on and so forth. These are the questions that we try to answer. That kind of studies are called qualitative dynamics. Now we are poised in a situation where we can tackle nonlinear systems. So, let us take the simplest possible nonlinear system, the simple pendulum. The simple pendulum is given by this, that you possibly know, right? What are the equilibrium points? Put x dot and y dot equal to 0, y is obviously 0, and sin x being 0 gives an infinite number of possibilities. 0, 2 pi, minus 2 pi, 4 pi, minus 4 pi, so on and so forth. They are all equilibrium points. Etcetera means there are actually infinite number of them. What we will do then? What we will do is that we will work out the Jacobian of this and then plug in each equilibrium point's position, obtain the Jacobian as a collection of numbers, obtain the eigenvalues and eigenvectors, and then we will infer what will be the behavior around each of the equilibrium points, and from there it will be possible to figure out what will be the global behavior. Can you quickly do this for this point and this point? Quickly. So, this being the actual F1 and F2, you first have to write the Jacobian matrix, then plug in this value, obtain the actual Jacobian matrix in terms of numbers, and then obtain the eigenvalues and eigenvectors. We will do this as we go along, unless you actually solve problems, you do not get very comfortable with what we are doing. It is necessary to. So, we have F1 is equal to y, F2 is equal to minus sin x. So, del F1 del x is 0, del F1 del y is 1, del F2 del x is minus cos x, and this one is 0. Simple stuff, put x equal to 0, this becomes minus 1 at 0, 0. This becomes minus 1. So at the and at pi 0, it becomes what about this? At pi, so these two simple matrices just obtain the eigenvalues, eigenvectors. First case is plus or minus 1, okay. Plus or minus 1, we will have two eigenvectors. To cut a long story short, this will be 45 degree lines. So, it will be like this. One of them will be associated with the outgoing positive eigenvalue, the other will be associated with the negative, plus or minus 1, you said, okay. Here is the point. Pi 0, what is the behavior around it? Well, did you say it right? You said it wrongly. This one is like this. 0 0 should be plus minus I. This will be plus minus I. Here it will be what you just said. This will be pi 0. Here it will be two things. One is the outgoing, the other is the incoming. And here would be, you just said, plus minus I. Plus minus I would be purely imaginary, and therefore there will be no decay or expansion. So these will be just circles. Okay? At minus pi, if you do it, you will find the same stuff. It will be the same kind of behavior. And what will happen is that this line will extend and bend around and join with this one. This line will extend and bend around and join this one, and so on and so forth. So that sort of completes the story. What is this equilibrium point? It is not a stable one, because in order for it to be called stable, any deviation should die down. It doesn't, right? If you give a perturbation, it goes on in the circle. The deviation does not die down, and therefore it's not stable. It is called a circle behavior. So it's simply called a circle. This equilibrium point is a circle equilibrium point, because the behavior around it are circles. What is this? It's a saddle, because one is positive, the other is negative. Okay. Can you physically visualize how the pendulum is behaving if you have an initial condition close to this one? Is this? What if you start here? Then the vector field shows that it will go like this. What is this? You have given a larger jolt to it, so that it goes like this. Okay? So this is the representation of that dynamical system in the phase space. It looks like this. And what is this point? It's actually this point. Pi 0 or minus pi 0 is this point. So it is vertically upwards. If you marginally, if you just release it there, mathematically it will stay there, but physically it will have slight perturbation. It will go there and then it will come back and stand there. That's what happens. Goes there, stands there. Okay. So we have done this. This will be the behavior totally. I just worked out on the board. So you see, this more or less leads you to believe that fine, nonlinear systems are simple enough. All we need to do is to work out the behavior around the equilibrium points in terms of matrices and sort of join the lines, right? Let's do one more exercise like that. I'll give you a set of differential equations which you try to solve. Just work out the qualitative behavior of the system. Double dot, so it's a 2D system. The first step will be to say x dot is equal to y, and then y dot is equal to so this is my function 1, this is function 2. Do the same stuff. How many equilibrium points does it have? 2. Where? 0 and minus 1. Okay. Just work out the behavior around these two. The pendulum was simple, somewhat common sense, but this has to be worked out. That's why I gave you this task. Zero zero will be okay. Zero zero is the eigenvalues are at this point is plus minus 1. The eigenvalues are, and how are the eigenvectors? Look, zero zero is. You calculate, I don't care. Now I'll not do it. Plus minus I? 1. Okay. And then the eigenvectors? See, when calculating the eigenvectors, you will get two equations which are essentially the same. Okay, so 45-degree lines. Which one is the associated with the plus one? Which one associated with the minus one? Plus one. This is the plus one. Huh? So it will be then. I'll put the arrows accordingly. Huh? And this will be then. What about at minus 1, 0? Plus minus I. So let it be this point. So around this, it will be like this. Okay? And then you see that in order to complete the story, all you need to do is to put it like this, and that will do. So you see, you can. You can work out the character of the vector field by actually working out the character of the vector field around the equilibrium points. Clear? Okay. But this story that I have told so far is only very tiny part of the story. In most cases, there will be more things that can be inferred by looking at just the eigenvalues and eigenvectors and the local neighborhood. Let's come to one such example. Take the equation like this and try to work it out. What time should I stop? Up to what time? 1. So here also you write the equations and then obtain the Jacobian and try to infer the behavior. Let's see what you infer. Exactly the same way you proceed. There is only one Jacobian to calculate, so this is not very difficult thing to do. But it will then depend on our mu, right? What it is? No, it will be complex, not purely imaginary. It will be complex because I see that there is a mu. No, wait. Just write as an expression involving mu, because I can see that mu cannot be wished away. Mu will be there in the result. It will be complex, that I agree, but I can see easily that since the equation contains mu, the eigenvalues will also contain mu. Just give me the expression of the eigenvalue including mu. Okay, let us see, you just keep on reading, let me write it, plus minus. This whole, are you getting this? Okay. Are you all getting this? So that was the local linearization. And then this is what he said. Okay. This leads us to the conclusion that so long as this mu is less than 2, this term will be bigger than that, and therefore the square root of a negative term will be complex. So it will be complex so long as the mu is smaller than 2. That is conclusion number 1. Conclusion number 2, by looking at this, is that whether or not the real part is positive or negative depends on the sign of mu, right? Which means that so long as mu is negative, it will be an incoming spiral, and the moment this mu becomes positive, it will become an outgoing spiral. Conclusion positive? Minus 2. That is where the interesting stuff starts, because this is what we can infer in terms of the linear theory. So this is what we can infer. We infer then that 0, 0 is the equilibrium point, and so long as mu is negative, it will be like this. For mu positive, it will be like that, right? That is what we can infer from this linear approximation. But the thing actually is non-linear. All this conclusion we have arrived at by actually locally linearizing, and therefore the conclusion that you have arrived at is valid only in the neighborhood, nowhere else. So this is valid in the neighborhood. Yes, you are right. But how do you say that it is valid also here? You cannot say. So if suppose you have got a machine in which you are changing some variable, which is mu is changing from negative value to positive value, then you know that it goes from an incoming spiral to outgoing spiral, but you can have no way to say that even here it going becomes an outgoing spiral. Suppose it then here remains incoming spiral and here it becomes outgoing spiral. What will happen? What will happen is that in the middle a round will a sort of closed loop will develop, so that if you give a perturbation to the inward, it will go outward and converge onto that. And if you give a perturbation outward, then it will come inward and converge onto that. Something like this. So for this system, actually calculated orbit for negative value of mu and for positive value of mu. See, from inside it goes out and converges onto this loop. From outside also it converges, it goes inward and converges onto this loop. This is something that is a typical nonlinear behavior which cannot be inferred from any linear theory. Okay. Now look at the character of this loop behavior. It is a cyclic behavior, it is an oscillating behavior. But then it's easily see, you can easily see that it is a stable oscillation. Part of it, it comes back to itself, right? It is a stable oscillation. Now let me make a sweeping statement. Any stable oscillation that you have seen in your life are all this type, because you cannot have a stable oscillation unless you have a character like this. This is called a limit cycle. So, tell us, what stable oscillations have you seen in your life? Oscillators. You studied in your second year or third year, I forgot, in the BSc, right? Oscillators. All the oscillators are limit cycles. Heart is a limit cycle. Human heart is an oscillator, limit cycle. Your waking up and sleeping rhythm is a limit cycle. So all these are the limit cycles, and the fact that you live means these things, if you perturb it, it still comes back to itself, means that these are strongly nonlinear systems and a nonlinearity playing its role in creating limit cycles. Clear? So this is a limit cycle. Now if you have a limit cycle, then it is a closed loop. If it is a closed loop in 2D, now a bit of topology. If it is a closed simple topology though, in a sheet of paper, if you have a closed loop like this, can you do it like this? This is also a closed loop. Can you have it like that? No, you cannot, because this is an intersection point. And in the phase space, there cannot be an intersection, because at every point there is a unique vector. At every point, the vector is unique, right? Therefore, this is ruled out, it cannot happen in 2D. But if it is in 3D, then there is no reason to believe that it is an intersection. It could be simply a projection of the behavior. So, it is possible to have it like that. So, in 3D onwards, you can have this kind of a behavior. Okay. Now suppose you are doing an experiment on the CRO screen, you put it on the XY mode, you see this. What will be the behavior in the time domain? How will the behavior be? It will be something like this. This is the point it reaches here, and it goes up to this point here, right? Stand to reason? Yeah. and this is the x versus t. Y versus t will also behave the same way. What is the character of that? It comes back to itself, comes back to the same state after two cycles. That is why it is called a period 2 limit cycle. It has two loops, it is easier to see there. It has two loops, it is called a period 2 limit cycle. And these things are pretty common. This, when it goes from period 1 limit cycle to period 2 limit cycle, there is something probably in the last class you handle, right? Period doubling. Was it taught? No, I will come to that, no problem. Okay, so this is a period 2 limit cycle. So this was the limit cycle. Okay, one thing has to be understood, that any loop is not a limit cycle. Any looping behavior is not a limit cycle. We have seen a behavior like that in a linear system. It is not a limit cycle because it has to limit onto the cycle. While in the if you have a linear system with purely imaginary eigenvalues, then depending on the initial condition, it goes into different loops. Therefore, it is not a limit cycle. Though it is cyclic, it is not a limit cycle. Limit cycle is where if you quantum it, still comes back to that. Then only it is a limit cycle. So, it is a limit cycle would be something like that. Mu greater than 0 is at the center, it goes into outgoing behavior. But then here a loop develops, outside it still remains incoming behavior. The mu greater than 0, that whatever we inferred are related to the local neighborhood here. Local neighborhood, it is the outgoing behavior. But outside is still incoming behavior. If you have a simple, I would not say exactly sinusoid, but some kind of a periodic oscillation in the phase space, it will be a limit cycle. And we have also seen that this is possible, but only in 3D or above, not in two dimensional systems. That is why this behavior cannot happen in the Van der Waals. The problem that we just solved cannot happen there. Well, if you have a system that is a Lorentz system, how would we, if we are given this set of equations, how would we handle it? Exactly the same way. We will first obtain the equilibrium points, we will obtain the local linear neighborhood, we will obtain the eigenvalues, eigenvectors. Go ahead. So, if you do that, this problem will be you can do it given enough time, because 3Ds are a bit more cumbersome to do by hand. So, let me tell you that there are three equilibrium points. One is at 0, 0, 0, the other two are at this point, at these two points. There you can see symmetrical, because the z part is the same. This is two positive numbers, exactly the same negative numbers. So, there are two symmetrical points in the phase space. And this is the Jacobian matrix. How do you proceed then? We plug in those values into the position of x, y, z in this matrix, obtain a set of numbers, and then on the basis of that, we can infer the behavior. Now, if you do that rigorously, you can, I'll always advise you to do that by hand, but that will take time. That is why I am just giving the result. For r is less than 1, there are three equilibrium points B and C. This B and C, those two guys do not exist. Look at the positions. R is less than 1 means they become imaginary, complex, and therefore, they do not exist in the real value space. So, they do not exist for r is less than 1. For r greater than 1, the point A, the first point, becomes unstable, and these two becomes comes into existence. It was not existing before. They come into existence. And so long as this range of r is satisfied, then these two equilibrium points have complex conjugate eigenvalues with real part negative, which means that they will be spiraling inwards. But for when r is bigger than 24.74, then the real parts become positive. What will happen? What will happen is that there are, see, here was an equilibrium point at 0, 0, 0. Here is one, here is one. Both these guys were incoming spiral, so long as the R is less than this. So, it will be like this, incoming and converging onto these two points. No difficulty in understanding. What happens if they go out? If they go out, then they will spiral outwards for R value bigger than 24.74. Spiraling outward means there are two planes, right? If you spiraling outward, it gets thrown into this plane. It spirals outward, gets thrown into this plane. It spirals outward, goes thrown into this plane, and ultimately it cannot escape. Right? We have a peculiar situation where it cannot escape. It becomes like this. You can clearly see two planes. These are the eigenplanes associated with the complex conjugate eigenvalues. Associated with the complex conjugate eigenvalues, it. Where did I keep the pointer? Yeah. It goes around like this, and it goes on like this, and gets thrown into this plane. It goes around like this outward. Gets thrown into this plane. Goes around like this outward. It's thrown into this plane. All the time, it's going trying to go out, but it cannot go out. Ultimately, the behavior is a bounded behavior. Yet the speciality is that it is not. It does not. Well, how do I say it? It is a bounded behavior, but no equilibrium point is stable, right? It does not have any stable equilibrium point. Still, it remains bounded. This behavior is called chaos. So, what is chaos? It is essentially bounded aperiodic behavior of a dynamical system. There is little more technicality to it, I will come to that, but that is the sort of common sense definition, you can say. Another important character of this is,
if I just look at this motion in real time, and then let's say I Fourier transform it, so the claim is then I'll just get peaks at irrational numbers. Is that
No. Actually, you will get values. Right. See, if it is a periodic one, it is a peaky behavior in a Fourier transform. Okay. While if it is chaos, then all the frequency spectrum will be filled.
Very densely filled,
okay. But there will be some peaks. So, there is a theory as to where will the peaks be, but that is a little more complex stuff. So, let us not get into that right now, but yes, this is where the spectrum gets spread all over. The other character is that if you start from two arbitrarily closed initial conditions. Say in this case, I have started this simulation from 0.77 and 0.00177. They for some time remain together, but after that they diverge out. This is called sensitive dependence on initial condition, another hallmark of chaos, which means that two very close initial conditions will sooner or later diverge out. It has immense implication because. How do I express it? Suppose some system is stable. Some system is stable. You have so far learned about stable systems. System is stable. Now, when we have studied classical mechanics, the whole structure of classical mechanics is that I want to predict something. How do I predict it? I write down the differential equations of it, and I look at the initial condition. I plug in the initial condition in the differential equation and I can predict, right? Now, let us see, let us analyze this particular act that is at the crux of all classical mechanics. We have written down the differential equation. Assume that you have written down the differential equation correctly. Still, you have the task of obtaining the initial condition. Now, suppose you are trying to predict the behavior of the Mars. What do? You take a binocular or a telescope and look at the Mars and find out its initial position, initial momentum, x naught, p naught, plug it in. Obviously, you cannot find out the initial condition of Mars with infinite accuracy. There will be always some error. mathematically speaking, you can make the statement that I do not know where the initial condition is, but the initial condition is contained in the ball. It is an, it's called an error ball. I do not know where exactly the initial condition is, but I know that it is somewhere inside. That depends on, I have measured something and I know my, my experimental accuracy is this much. This much is the accuracy in the measurement of the position, and this much is the inaccuracy in the measurement of the momentum, and therefore the thing is somewhere inside this ball. Okay? Okay. Now, how would you then in this setting try to predict? The way we do it is that we solve the differential equation starting from all the points inside that ball, right? So after some time, it gives some other shape on the ball, right? And you can say with confidence that my final condition is somewhere inside that ball. Now, in stable systems, the character is that this ball shrinks. This ball shrinks so that the prediction becomes very accurate. You can accurately predict. But in a unstable system, what happens? The ball expands, and therefore it is not possible to be, to predict the behavior of an unstable system. Is a chaotic system stable or unstable? It is stable in the sense that it is not going to infinity. It is unstable in the sense that no equilibrium point is stable, right? So it is somewhere between being stable and unstable. उसमें क्या होगा वो जो the prediction of the future उसका क्या होगा. Notice what happens is that every equilibrium point has an expanding direction and contracting direction because these are saddles, right? So what will happen is something like this. Suppose you started from a ball, if it ball means ball of the initial conditions, all possible initial conditions subject to my measurement. If it is a stable system, it becomes smaller and therefore the prediction becomes more or less accurate. If it is unstable system, it becomes larger, and so on, goes to infinity. Therefore, I cannot predict. In a chaotic system, it is unstable in the sense that it goes in one direction, cucumber ho jata hai. After some time it becomes a longer cucumber, but then after some time the cucumber folds. If it folds, then it is not going to infinity, right? After some time, take this whole thing and the whole thing again becomes like that, longer, and the whole thing then folds. Okay, so it's becoming longer and then folding, becoming longer and folding, stretching and folding, stretching and folding. That is the hallmark of chaos. There is always stretching and folding. Have you ever seen your mother make paratha? So she takes a duff and she rolls, stretching, and then she folds, and then she stretches again, then she folds. Why? Because then the oil will go in, right? So that is that structure, infinitely stretches, stretched and folded structure, is the character of the phase space of a chaotic system. Chaos is essentially that. Clear? How much time? Yeah. Yes.
Presumably our solar system is also chaotic, right? So if I just look at planetary motions, what is this analog of stretching and folding in the
I mean if give scripts, if you really understand the solar system is chaotic.
So presumably it's chaotic because more than three bodies
right? Even three body system is chaotic.
Yeah.
Yeah. And therefore, since there are so many bodies, it's obviously chaotic. But the advantage is that the rate of separation, right, the how fast the two nearby initial conditions separate, that represents how chaotic it is, how strongly chaotic it is, and in the case of the solar system, it is very small. So within our time scales, we will never feel the chaoticity of the system. But over millions of years, you do feel. The position of our planet is not where it was a million years ago. Position of the moon is not where it was a million years ago. So, all these things change. So that is how we need to say these time scales are in this case larger, but it is a chaotic system. In fact, realization of the fact that it is a chaotic system is sort of the starting point of the whole study of chaos. I suppose in the in the year 1911 or something like that, the king of which place? I forgot which place, but he wanted to prove that the solar system is stable. So he, Austria is it? I forgot. Some king. Okay, the kings are like that. So they have some idea. So he, what he did was, he inserted an advertisement in a newspaper saying that if anybody can prove that the solar system is stable, then I'll give him a prize of a lifetime. So a few proofs came, and one of the people who proved it was Poincaré, Henri Poincaré, and so he got the prize. He was happy, but when he went back, he realized that there's a problem in the proof. And he worked on that, and finally realized that the whole proof was wrong. The solar system is indeed unstable. And price he kept, of course. Who gives away the prize? Once you win it. Well, so this is the essence of chaos. There is one other type. See, I have discussed about a few qualitatively different types of behavior that can be found in a dynamical system. We have said that there can be an equilibrium point which is stable. Start from here, goes in there. Going into there can be in a linear way, real eigenvalues. Going into there can be in a spiral way, complex conjugate eigenvalues. And we have also seen that there can be periodic orbits, which are limit cycles. We have also seen that there can be period 2 orbits, period 3 orbits, period 4 orbits, all this possible, and this period infinity orbits, the chaotic orbit. But this one other type of behavior which is possible, that is something like this. If such a system happens in your experiment, you look at the CRO screen, you see a waveform, something like this. You can easily see that this is a combination of two sinusoids or two frequencies, right? When there is a combination of two frequencies, there are two possibilities. These two frequencies may be commensurate or incommensurate. Only two possibilities. If it is commensurate, then starting anywhere, ultimately it will come back to the same initial condition, right? If it is commensurate, suppose one frequency is 2, another frequency is 3, then after 6 cycles it will come back to itself, right? So if they are commensurate, then it is actually a periodic orbit. But there is a speciality that it is not the periodic orbit that we have seen earlier, it is actually a collection of two frequencies, and these are called mode locked periodic orbits. A very common example of that is the motion of the moon around the earth. You see, it is a mode locked periodic orbit. It is a very, very nonlinear phenomenon due to which mode locking happens. And out of all the satellites in the solar system, 90% are mode locked in some way or other. Because the moon is mode locked, and mode locking at a 1:1 frequency ratio, that is why you see only one side of the moon. You do not see the other side. Not the dark side. We see the moon because it is that side is lit, but but the other side we don't see. Why don't we see? Because as it goes around, the same side faces. So by the time it comes to the same position, it has also gone exactly one cycle. So this revolution and this rotation have exactly the same frequency. It is mode locked. And this mode locking is another very typical nonlinear phenomenon. I may not have time to deal with it in detail in this course, but this is another type of behavior. But we have to understand what does it look in the phase space. In the phase space, it is a torus. In the phase space, it is a torus. In one direction, it is like this, one frequency, moving like this, another frequency like that, right. So, an orbit lying on the surface of a torus is another possibility in a dynamical system, which happened pretty frequently. And the moment you simply consider the possibilities within the solar system, you realize that this is very, very common. So, these are the few different types of dynamical systems that are possible. Well, I will come to that in next class. With this, 3 minutes left, time for three questions. They are not all mode locked in 1:1 ratio.
Okay, not
no, ratio. No, different ratios.
But why is it?
This is a very typical nonlinear phenomenon. If you have two oscillators that are, say, electronics, you have learned about oscillators, right? Make two oscillators and simply connected by a wire. You will find in no time they will not synchronize, but synchronize this way. That means they will become mode locked. Synchronize means becoming exactly the same frequency. That may or may not happen, but they will become mode locked. So, if there are, because there are actually nonlinear systems, the nonlinearity actually does this job, but the underlying theory is a bit more complicated than that. That's why I am not being able to go into that. But effectively, what has been found is that if there are two oscillators, suppose, do it another way. Suppose there is one oscillator with a hard frequency, 100 hertz, another oscillator with a variable frequency, which you are coupling them somehow. Over a very large range of the parameter that you are varying, they become 1:1 ratio mode locked. Then as you further change, suddenly the mode locking disappears. And then as you change further, it becomes 2:1 mode locked. And then, so why does it mode lock? That is a typical nonlinear effect that happens. So, this mode locking is a very important phenomenon, but you have to remember, if the two frequencies are incommensurate, then what happens? That means the ratio is an irrational number, then it will never come back to itself, but it still keep on winding around that torus, it will never come back to itself. In that sense, it has the same character as the chaotic behavior, because the chaotic behavior also does not come back to itself, it is aperiodic, it is also aperiodic, but it does not have a sensitive dependence on initial condition. So, that kind of behavior is called quasi-periodicity. The term quasi-periodicity refers to that kind of behavior, where there are two frequencies in the system and the two frequencies are incommensurate. Yeah, that means if you start for two initial conditions, they both are going to go like this. The separation will remain the same. The separation will not increase or decrease. Exactly that. The measure of how fast two nearby initial conditions separate out, or exponential separation, if you represent that by exponential e to the power lambda t, what the lambda is, that is essentially a measure of how chaotic is the system, and for a quasi periodic orbit it is essentially zero. That's it. For a chaotic system it is positive, for a stable system it is negative. So, it is a measure of the dynamical character of the system.
In the example you gave, you have these two planes.
Yes.
Went from one to the other.
Right.
I mean, the planes were sort of well defined.
Yeah.
Imagine a bounded motion in which the planes also actually move and do things.
Yes.
So, those must be there.
Yes. Highly possible. We took a rather simple system where these two are fixed, yet we have a chaos.
Yes.
But yes, you can always move this around.
Erratically.
Yes. Yeah.
So, when you were dealing with this van der Waals equation.
No, wait. By the way, that will happen if the R parameter that was there in the Lorentz system, that is sort of a say periodically varying, then this planes will also vary continuously.
So, and then you got this limit sign.
Yeah.
You at least showed the limit sign. So, mean, of course, it doesn't come from a linear analysis, but is there a way to sort of keep on perturbing and go to a?
No, it cannot be obtained from any linear analysis.
Solve the full non-linear.
Yes, it doesn't come from the linear analysis.
Yes,
there are ways. There is something called a Poincaré-Bendixson theorem, but I'll not get into that because you can learn, you can get a more or less good grasp of the system, subject without this, you know, getting into this details. So what I plan to do, since I have three classes, I would give an overall view of the system. So yes, there is some way of predicting whether or not there will be a limit cycle. There are ways, but we can live without that.